A verse from Psalm 4. There are many who say, "Oh, that we might see some good. Let the light of your face shine on us, O Lord." Jesus appears to the disciples in probably one of the strangest times that they experienced in their lives. They're struggling to come to terms with the events of the crucifixion and what Jesus' death by crucifixion meant for their community. Then, various people start giving accounts of encounters with the risen Jesus. So then the apostles and disciples are simultaneously trying to come to terms with his death, as well as these reports of his resurrection. And then he appears to the gathered 11. The different gospels give slightly different accounts of how things went. Last week we heard from the Gospel of John about the apostles and Thomas's encounter with the risen Jesus. This week we hear from the perspective of the Gospel of Luke. Some of the elements are the same, mainly that Jesus appears to the gathered group. He meets them in a closed room and challenges them in their fear. Of particular note, though, is that this week's gospel reading comes immediately after the story of the disciples on the road to Emmaus. That's where two of the disciples are walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And then they encounter the risen Jesus. Once they discover who he is, once he is revealed to them and disappears, they run the 7 miles, or 11 kilometers if you're in Canada, back to tell the apostles what they had seen and what they had experienced. And then as they are telling the apostles what they saw, Jesus appears in their very midst. Another piece of scripture, words from another gospel, words that are very familiar to all of us. "For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them." Whether that's two of the disciples on the road to Emmaus, the 11 gathered and hearing reports, people running to the tomb in the morning, Jesus is there. "Peace be with you." Words spoken that we heard in the gospel last week, and Jesus breathed on them. Words spoken at the very beginning of the gospel reading this week, when Jesus appears, his first words to them. Now, in study material, it says that this was a very traditional and common Jewish greeting, a way literally just to say hello. And yet, it also is something that Jesus and the disciples and apostles used to give people a sign that the kingdom of God had come near. This is, in fact, the cornerstone of Jesus' ministry. Jesus makes the common, the everyday, that which we gloss over and take for granted, into something holy. Jesus asks the apostles to be witnesses. He asks them to be witnesses to the transformation of the common and the everyday, the taken for granted, into that which is most holy. This was such a major part of what Jesus did, that transformation. Not an outward and visible transformation, in the sense that people went from rags to being clothed with luxurious textiles and decked with gold and silver, but a transformation that was the restoring of humanity, the restoring of self-worth, healing of brokenness, brokenness of heart, mind, soul, and yes, as we hear in so many scripture stories, healing of body as well. And so in that sense, there is also a tangible outward transformation, but not simply some kind of a window dressing, but rather a radiance of the glory of God manifest in us. It is a complete and total transformation. It is God's proclamation that you are worth everything. So Jesus meets the disciples in the midst of their fear and confusion. But he challenges them not to stay there. He reassures them that he is not, in fact, a ghost, that his body is resurrected. He invites them to touch his hands and feet. And then, as further proof, he asks them for something to eat. This is most important because it is also so much a part of what Jesus did, breaking bread with them. The major stories of the Last Supper, the feeding of the 4,000, the feeding of the 5,000, and so many other instances where Jesus shares food, that common everyday occurrence that we all participate in. And Jesus changes that common and everyday and makes it whole. And then he does something very interesting. He challenges them on their understanding of the Messiah. What was expected was some kind of a second coming of King David, who would lead the people to rise up and overthrow the Roman Empire who invaded their land that had been promised to them by God, promised to their forefathers. Just as he had done for the disciples on the road to Emmaus, Jesus reinterprets the scriptures for them, beginning with the law of Moses, the Torah, and moving through the prophets, so that they might understand that this idea of the Messiah they had was wrong. But instead, Jesus, riding humbly into Jerusalem on a donkey, and not a war horse, was in fact the Messiah that they were expecting. Not a great king and warrior, and not bloodshed and war, but instead Jesus and a ministry full of grace and mercy, compassion and healing, teaching and forgiveness of sins, teaching of radical inclusion and hospitality. Not without a sharp word or two, but not the Messiah that they were expecting. And finally, Jesus commissions them to be witnesses to all of this, to his life, to his teaching, to his ministry, to his death, and most importantly, to his resurrection. He asks them to carry on this ministry of bringing the kingdom of God to people. Peace be with you. When he sent them out earlier in the scripture stories, he asked them to go to people's houses and bring peace to their houses, telling them that the kingdom of God had indeed come near. He sends them out to preach and proclaim that good news, to preach and proclaim salvation, the forgiveness of sins, to preach healing and new life, to preach that inward change and transformation that becomes an outward expression of love of God and love of neighbor. This hope-filled message of life that Jesus commissions them to go out to the whole world, starting in Jerusalem, right where they were. We are called to that same ministry, starting right where we were.